anointed and inspired by the Holy Spirit. If it's coming out of the deep of your spirit and this expression of your heart, it's a legitimate form of praise and worship. Okay? Now, this is absolutely amazing to me. Under Charles I and Queen Mary, who was called Bloody Mary, even psalm singing, along with hymn singing, was totally banned in church services. But thanks be unto God, you could not completely suppress the song of the heart. Accounts were given about how thousands of people would gather together after the services. Now, they weren't allowed to sing in the services, but they would gather together after the services and sing praises to God. As I said, it's been only since the Civil War, about 1866, where the Presbyterian Church had even begun to allow organs within their buildings. Let's move to post-Reformation. I think that when we go through all of this, it's probably going to give us a new appreciation for music. I think it's going to show us how far we've come spiritually. Hopefully, it'll put psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs in proper perspective. Maybe it'll give you a different outlook toward hymns. You remember a couple of weeks ago when I read to you, anybody have your book here tonight? Let me see if I can find that. You recall when I read to you, that was in the chapter on prophetic, talking about hymns. You remember that?
Page 136.
Okay, let me just make a brief reference to that here. I want to stay with my outline here, but I think this will probably fit in. A prominent American clergyman compiled the following 10 reasons for opposing the new music trend of his day. You have to keep in mind, of course, that there was a time that hymns represented the new music trend. Number one, it's too new, like an unknown language. Number two, it's not so melodious as a more established style. Number three, there are so many new songs that it is impossible to learn them all. Number four, this new music creates disturbances and causes people to act in an indecent and disorderly manner. Remember what we said a moment ago about many of the religious leaders were afraid the church was going to be turned into a theater. In fact, some of the music that got away from the trend of the day was called licentious and sensuous. It was lewd. It caused people to become worldly. Number five, it places too much emphasis on instrumental music rather than on godly lyrics. You remember how that we went through the history and we said that for many centuries, musical instruments were not even allowed in the church. Number six, the lyrics are often worldly, even blasphemous. Let me remind you that many of the great hymns of the church, what we call the great hymns of the church, what we presently call the great hymns of the church are the songs that were written primarily by Isaac Watts and John and Charles Wesley. We'll talk more about that in just a moment. The great hymns of the church. Many of those hymns, especially the Wesleys, in fact, I would say that Martin Luther, the Wesleys, who's the other? Isaac Watts. All would take tunes to worldly music. Some of the what we call the hymns of the church today are actually tunes to what was worldly music of that day. Did you know that Amazing Grace is an old barroom tune originally? Isn't that amazing? So what do we do now? We criticize people for taking the tune or the melody from a secular song and put Christian words to it. And that's exactly what the hymn writers did. Number seven, it is not needed since preceding generations have gone to heaven without it. I like it. Number eight, it is a contrivance to get money. Number nine, it monopolizes the Christian's time and encourages them to stay out late. Number 10, these new musicians are young upstarts, and some of them are lewd and loose persons. And all of that was referring to hymns. Okay. During the post-reformational period, there was still a great struggle concerning music in the church. The main focus here was on the singing of hymns. I've already identified several of the controversies prior. One was congregational singing, the other was instruments in the church, the other was the singing of hymns, and the other was the part singing. The primary controversy in this period of time right here was the singing of hymns. King James, you remember King James, King Jimmy, not only gave us the most popular version of the Bible today, but he also sanctioned a book of hymns and songs of the church. He was forced to withdraw it because of the opposition of the church. The giants, the musical giants in this period of time were Bach and Handel. Both had to battle for expression and recognition of the talents that God had given them. Then you come on down, the Puritans were still pretty antagonistic toward musical expression. Now we come to Isaac Watts. The church at the time that Isaac Watts came on the scene was still pretty much limiting the singing and music to the hymn, to the Psalms. Here's what Isaac Watts did in order to break the ice, to get a foot in the door, so to speak. Instead of taking the actual word-for-word psalm, he would paraphrase a psalm. See, all of the psalm singing before had been the actual word-for-word expression of the Bible. But then Isaac Watts paraphrased the Psalms. And eventually, that opened the door for him to begin to compose hymns. There was a note of joy in the hymns that he wrote. The 20th century owes much to Isaac Watts because he was the early pioneer in congregational singing. I've already made reference to the Moravians. Let's move on to John and Charles Wesley. Of course, John and Charles Wesley were converted out of the Anglican Church of England before they were converted, or let me put it this way, before they came out of the Anglican Church, they had actually been brought into court on the charge that they were being sacrilegious in the introduction of music that was not sanctioned by the church, namely the singing of psalms. Needless to say that John and Charles Wesley has probably been given credit for writing more hymns than any other two people. Together they wrote over 6,000 hymns. The great revivalists such as Charles Finney, Jonathan Edwards, and George Whitefield gave great thrust to the singing of the music of Isaac Watts as well as the Wesleys. Now we move on to the modern era, the modern period as we know it today. I think sometimes we take the Salvation Army for granted. We don't really realize how much impact the Salvation Army has had. We usually think the Salvation Army is just ringing the little bell during the Christmas season and taking your money. I think that probably most people have a great deal of confidence in the Salvation Army. The Salvation Army has a great amount of credibility. I think that the public as a whole has come to accept the Salvation Army as being an organization that has been very mindful of the needs of people. I don't think a lot of people realize that the Salvation Army is actually a church within itself. We see the Salvation Army bands, the trumpets, trombones, and so forth. But what I think most of us today don't realize is that the Salvation Army has to be given a great deal of credit in the revolution, the Reformation and the revolution of music in the church. The Salvation Army were some of the first to clap their hands in a church service, to play tambourines, to shout hallelujah, and to have various musical instruments, including drums. See, there are a lot of churches that won't allow drums even today. There are a lot of staunch churches that 25, 30 years ago would only have a piano and organ in the church. I had the privilege of spending 6 weeks in Brazil in 1975. And one of the things that really blessed me was the joy and the excitement and the praise and the worship. All the churches that I went into and the meetings that we had for those 6 weeks, I never saw the first piano or organ. There were guitars and there were drums, accordions, a lot of excitement, a lot of expression of joy, which was very inspirational. Of course, you heard these guys come back from Peru talking about the spontaneity, the excitement that was expressed in the praise and the worship, the genuineness, the outflow. I think that we've lost a lot of that in this country. I believe that God wants there to be a fresh move, a fresh realization that there should be an expression out of the deep of our spirit. There should be a spontaneous expression of praise and worship to the Lord, even with all manner of musical instruments. I grew up in the Assemblies of God, which, of course, you understand that the Assemblies of God begin on what we call the wrong side of the tracks. But somewhere back, I don't know, a few decades ago, they moved what they called on the right side of the tracks. They lost a lot of their distinctives that were associated with those early days. I guess most of the Assembly of God churches that I was associated with in those days were the country style. We belonged to a couple of churches that had piano and organs, but I know the church that Nancy and I grew up in, man, we had all kinds of exciting music back in the early 50s, right? I moved to Memphis in 1955, graduated from high school there, went to an Assembly of God church. Fortunately, this particular Assembly of God church that we went to in the city of Memphis was the country style. I mean, it was just an old hellfire and brimstone little country preacher, you know, that gladly allowed me to play my guitar in church. I had as some of my best friends two young men that were very outstanding musicians. In fact, at one time, they started a brand new church in Memphis as young men. I think one was 18, the other was 20. I went to college with them, very close friends with them. They started that church within 3 or 4 years, became the second largest Assembly of God church in the state of Tennessee. As close of friends as we were, they made it clear to me that I would not be welcome in their church with my guitar. I said, guess what? I won't be coming to your church because my guitar is not welcome. I'm not welcome. Amen? So even Pentecostal churches, I mean, you've come a long way in what they, I guess, I don't know. I think now there's probably a couple of reasons. Number one is that unfortunately, I think sometimes in our desire to become like the rest of the world, quote, to be accepted by them, that we compromise and we have taken on their, I don't know. Unfortunately, I think the Pentecostals have lost a great deal in trying to appeal to the masses. I think that what we need to do and what we do here, of course, we just go ahead and praise God, do we not? Mm-hmm. One thing I appreciate about this church is that we do have the freedom of expression, and yet we have some guidelines. We have We have decency and order, right? But church has come a long ways, and then of course drums have probably been the last instrument accepted into the church. But the Salvation Army was originally given the credit for that. We want to look at the emerging of what we call the gospel song. Now, of course, the Bible talks about psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. Doesn't say anything about gospel songs. You ever think about that? What a lot of people call hymns are just simply gospel songs. There is a distinction between what we call a hymn and a gospel song. One of the things that I've come to realize now is that if you go back to some of your great hymn writers, such as Isaac Watts, John and Charles Wesley, Martin Luther, back in the 1500s, 1600s, and 1700s, are probably some of the most powerful songs that have ever been written. In fact, John and Charles Wesley have been given credit for composing hymns that are solidly based in theology, very theologically sound. You go back to some of those old hymns and you don't hear some of this ridiculous stuff, you know, that you've heard in the last 50 years about "I'll fly away, oh glory." You know, "Build me a mansion next door to Jesus." Those are gospel songs. They don't have a bit of theology in them. In fact, most of them are loaded with false doctrine. We're going to change the tape and then we're going to continue. And when you have these songs that are talking about the coming of the Lord, you don't hear anything about the rapture. You really don't. Good, solid, doctrinally based theological songs. So we do have to make a distinction between what we consider good, solid, inspired hymns and these feel-good gospel songs. Now, one thing we do want to say about what we call the gospel song is that many of them were born out of the enthusiasm associated with camp meetings, brush arbors, revivals. It represented a real emotional type of expression to the Lord. Unfortunately, a lot of these songs don't go much beyond the emotions. Don't have a whole lot of theology, but they did meet a particular need. For those that may be familiar with some of the recent gospel songs, and I say the recent gospel songs, I would say at least in the 20th century, the latter part of the 19th century and the 20th century, we're probably familiar with Ira D. Sankey, who was D.L. Moody's campaign singer. It was under his ministry of song and music that thousands and thousands of people were really excited and enthused. You can't really take away that excitement. I think, again, that we need excitement, but it needs to be more than just emotions. In fact, some of you that remember back in the earlier days, and I'm talking about, I don't know, I guess I'm talking about folks that are 50 or older, you probably recall, and in some of these little church, look around, I don't know, sorry, maybe I ought to back off of that, 40. But perhaps some of you recall being in a church service where just as sure as you pull out a certain emotional song, little old sister so-and-so is going to jump up, woo! Preachers, there were preachers who knew exactly what button to pull, to push, what lever to pull, what song to sing, because it always got the same response from the same people. I believe they were very sincere, but I believe they were just really motivated by emotion. As I've said, the Pentecostals, who was it last night? I guess it was Pastor Ledbetter who said that, oh, she was quoting Bishop Polk about how that Pentecostalism is the fastest growing movement in the world. Pentecostalism is certainly sweeping South America. South America has been predominantly Catholic. I would say that even probably today, even those who are Pentecostal in expression will still call themselves, nominally, they'll call themselves Catholics. But probably, I would say the Pentecostal churches in some places in South America are probably as dominant, or probably more so, they're more effective, more dominant than the Catholic Church. The Catholic Church still has the numbers, though, of course. But one of the things that's associated with Pentecostalism has been the aliveness, the excitement of the singing, the spontaneity, the expression of their faith, which was through hymns, gospel songs, and then, of course, gospel songs. Then you come to the charismatic renewal. One of the things that I remember about the charismatic renewal in the early days, and the thing that really excited me, was the introduction, which may not have been so much the introduction, might have been the re-establishment of the singing of psalms, scriptural songs. One of the things that has been identified with the charismatic movement has been the singing of scriptures. Much of the scripture today that I can recall has been a song that I sung, a psalm that has been set to music. Again, you don't throw the baby out with the bathwater, right? There was a time that only the singing of psalms was allowed in the church. But then we went through a period of time that we kind of got carried away. We got involved in these other types of music, and we forgot about the legitimacy of the singing of psalms. And that's one of the things that the charismatic renewal brought into the church. Part of the charismatic renewal, and what we call the charismatic renewal, actually began about 1950. The early days of the charismatic renewal were really known as the days of latter rain. There were several distinctives associated with latter rain. As far as music was concerned, there was a reintroduction of singing spiritual songs. Everybody staying with me? You understand now the three distinctives that the Bible talks about? What are they? Psalms, hymns, spiritual songs. Spiritual songs, again, being what? Singing in the Spirit. There have been numerous accounts of people who literally heard the heavenly choir. I've heard Nancy's aunt talk about that. I've heard her talk about actually having experienced services where people would literally would hear the heavenly choir. Now, you talk about entering into a high dimension of praise and worship. And I believe that's what God is desiring, is that we join forces with heaven, that we're in concert with heaven. We're orchestrated. Heaven and earth is orchestrated together in glorifying the Lord, because in eternity there will forever be before the throne of God worship, praise, glory, and honor to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And that's what God is desiring to bring us into, of course, in these days. The winds of change are blowing. Would you say amen to that? Many churches are being challenged afresh and anew with what God is saying and doing today. Of course, as has always been the case, there is a resistance to change. You go back, every period of time in the history of the music of the church, there has been a resistance to change. There has been the desire of the church of that moment, or of that time, to hold on to the status quo. But again, I believe that God has blessed and privileged us here to certainly be willing to break out of the ordinary in many regards. Guess what? God wants you to break out of the ordinary even more. Yes. Some people would certainly consider some of the things that we do and the way we express ourselves, the way we worship the Lord, as being out on the fringes and out in the extreme. But the important thing is that God be glorified. One of the things that I believe that we're seeing again in the restoration of the church is the church moved to decline and then began its upward trek, is that the song of the Lord is once again being returned to the house of the Lord. There's a scripture in the Song of Solomon, or in the Song of Songs, that says something to the effect that winter is past. And there is a sound of, well, it doesn't say the sound of music, but there's a sound of the singing of the birds, right? Why? Because there is an awakening. There's a refreshing. I believe that God is and is going to do more so in the days to come in giving His people fresh songs of the Lord. How many times have you been challenged? How many times has this ministry been challenged to let God flow through you? Let God minister in you and through you, even in the singing of a new song unto the Lord. I'm going to pray and believe God with you right now that God will continue to do the work of restoration, and that there will be a spirit of creativity that's going to be released in this place. We're coming, of course, to the conclusion of this course. And let me remind those of you that are taking the class for credit that I don't have your take-home exam tonight. Hopefully I'll have it by this weekend, and I'll give you about a week to get that back. I'm not going to give you unlimited time. Now, if you were taking a regular class and we set an exam time, you take that exam and that would be it. So if I say you take this test home, it doesn't mean that you have an indefinite amount of time. I'm going to give you 1 week, okay? 1 week from the day I give you that test is going to be expected back. But I want us to set ourselves in agreement in the conclusion of this lesson tonight, as well as the conclusion of the course, that God's going to release something very special. Why don't we all stand? Push your chairs aside and let's stand together tonight. Take someone by the hand. Reach over and take someone by the hand. Praise God. Praise God, praise God, praise God. Father, I ask you in the name of Jesus to release that special gifting, that special anointing. I ask in the name of Jesus that you would begin to stir up those creative arts. And Lord, that you would begin to release songs. Lord, I know that even in my own spirit, that many times I've laid on my bed at night, there's been a praise that's come out of my heart. There's been a way that I've expressed myself that when I would awaken, I would not really comprehend what was happening. But I believe, Father, you're going to give us all a clear understanding. You're going to show us that there is going to be an expression, an outward expression of that which we feel down deep inside. I ask in the name of Jesus that you would release that anointing, release that special creativity here tonight in the name of Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. Father, we give you praise. We give you glory and honor. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus. Lord, I want to thank you for the price that's been paid. In every age, every period of time in history, thank you for those who paved the way. Thank you, Lord, for those who were even willing to give their lives, to shed their blood, to bring us to this day. And we don't take that for granted. We don't take that lightly. We believe that this is a special day of visitation. We ask you, Father God, in the name of Jesus, to visit your people afresh and anew. Give us a song in our heart. Give us a song in our hearts, O God. Hallelujah. Blessed be thy name. Lift your voice to the Lord. Lift your heart to the Lord. Begin to glorify him. Begin to glorify him. Hallelujah.